Thank you for the opportunity to speak about Royal Lampicus and to take you into the story where we are and to take you into the story what we want to achieve and what impact we want to make as a large trader. Royal Lampicus, we are a large trader in pot plants, so we don't do any flowers. For that part, José will come into the picture, but we do the pot plants. And we supply about 12 large retail companies in Europe. Think about OBI, think about B&Q for the UK people, and think about IKEA. Those large retailers, they all have their own missions, and I wonder, retailers have been spoken about before, and I want to bring another light on that, because I think it's not as black as white as it's been stated before. Who is Royal Lampicus? As 136 years ago, we started as a grower, and so Royal Lampicus has a green heart. That's the start and our roots. We believe in plants because we think they create a better life for people. They give opportunity for a strong business together, and we can contribute to a healthier green world with them. And that could be an indoor world, and it could be an outdoor world. So as well the production, as well the end of life at the consumer end, plants can help and can diminish stress at home and in offices. And further, we strive for sustainable growth. In the first place of our people, so for my colleagues and myself, in our company we do emphasize a lot on training and on development of our people. Because we think if we develop our people, we will develop the relationships with our suppliers and develop relationships with customers. And in the end, we will make sustainable growth of our common business a reality. And the last word, together, that's why I'm here together with José. We really try to work together not only with our suppliers and our customers, but as well with our colleagues, or how do you want it, to know them. But a lot of them are here. Van Dijk Flora, Fleur Metz has been mentioned before. I think David is going to meet them tomorrow. Gijs is here from Royal Flora Holland. We work together with. And Waterdrinker, not here, but definitely to mention. We work together with a lot of companies because we think together we can have a greater impact. And what do we believe? We believe in plants, but we do believe in the people I just explained. We believe in scale because we think if we deliver to large retailers, scale does really have an impact. And not only commercial-wise or logistic-wise, but it does have an impact as well if you think about sustainability issues. If we can change something for a large retailer, then we can change a lot in one go. The only option is, the only challenge is, we need to find the solution. We think and believe in transparency, and we believe in data. And I was really pleased that I saw Boudewijn before here standing talking about the footprint. We did our footprint. We made our own footprint of Royal Lampicus. And there was some real basic facts and figures came up. And it really gave us an in-depth on our own business and where we could improve and on what areas we should make impact in our own business, not in the entire supply chain, but just our own business. Togetherness, I just already explained, and every day a little bit better is just a slogan. You cannot achieve and grow and climb up the mountain in one day, but every day we climb a little bit higher. And the last is force for good. That's really a belief which comes from the heart of the company, our owner, but as well the directors. Force for good is really something we see as our goal. So not only making more money as a trainer, of course, we do need to make some profit because otherwise we can't survive, but making impact is the biggest thing. And it's actually really nice to work for a company who says, I'd rather have that you make impact at least than you make more money. So it's quite a challenge as well, and it's difficult at the start because a lot of people are not used to it, but making impact is really a different thing. And you see after a couple of years that it really makes the people who work at a company such as Lemke's, that their things and their behavior is changing. So force for good. And if related then to plastics, because we're talking about plastics here, what are the circumstances for plastics? We have the environment, spoken about before, I'm not going to elaborate on that so much. We have the society. There is a large discussion at the moment on plastics. We all see plastics everywhere, around, on the roads, on the streets, on the market, in the schoolyard, everywhere. And we have a large discussion on it. If we go to the supermarket and you come home and you start cooking, then you end up with a bag of plastic in the end. And is that really necessary? We see that the government is struggling with plastics. The waste systems mentioned before, but as well we see on the other hand that the government is making a lot of decisions and policies on the plastic packs. We see a plastic pack in the UK, one of our retailers signed now a plastic pack in France, we have a plastic pack in the Netherlands, so there's all different kind of plastic packs coming up now, and actually those make all stakeholders work together, the government is supporting them and helping them and guiding them. And then we have the retail. Now, I think the retail feels responsible. I heard different things, stories before, but I definitely think they feel responsible and they want to make change. Only they have the same problem. How? So how should we do that? And I see now over the last 4 years a really big change in retailers who are coming from, we need to do something, but not making a decision yet, to last week I spoke to a retailer who said, oh, by the way, Elise, one of our goals is to reduce the plastics in the garden supply area. I said, oh, it's very nice that you tell me only now in April, but okay, so what is the goal then? And he said, now for this year, we need to make a plan. Now, I was really impressed that a retailer, a large retailer, is coming to me and saying, okay, at least they make it their own goal now. So I think they do make steps, but we need to help them. And they really need support from all areas. So I do think they really want to achieve and they feel responsible. And I think they feel the cost of recycling. And that makes them do something, so that helps as well. The recycling taxes in Germany, for instance, are a nice example. I think there was someone from Teku speaking this afternoon, and I hope he will explain a little bit more about that, because that really could help us. Those kind of policies could help us to change, to make change possible. And then we see consumers, they think just waste is annoying. Like I said before, if I'm cooking and I have just a plastic bag full of plastic after I've cooked, it's annoying. So. But if we want to go to circularity, what challenges do we face? In the first instance, I fully agree with David, the supply chains are complex. It's enormous complex. So it's not just a plant we transport from A to B. No, there's a lot happening with the plant. So we need to look at plastics and packaging on a sustainable issue, but it needs to be cost-wise effective, and it needs to be functional, because we have created plastic for a reason, and so we need to look at that side as well. I think the biggest challenge is actually behavioral change. How do we get the change? How do we get to change the consumers? How do we change ourselves? Because we don't like to get dirty hands, and we really like the opportunity of a bag to put something in and keep your car clean and make it easier for yourself, the convenience part. So plastics have a good point as well, and we shouldn't let it go from our sight. There's no uniform recycling system in Europe. I understood that it's even not in the UK in every community equal, but definitely not in the whole of Europe. We did some fact and figures search, and we found that 70% of the carton and paper in Europe is recycled, but only 30% of the plastics. So it's really a big difference. But I do remember when I was little, even paper recycling was an issue. So I think in 20 years' time, plastic recycling will be normal. But that means behavioral change. That means that everybody needs to adapt to a new system. And a final destination mentioned before as well, where does plastic end up in the supply chain? So does it end up at the consumer? Like the pot plant, the pot around the plant, that will definitely end up at the consumer. And so we have to look at that type of plastic in a different way as we have, for instance, the transport packaging, the trays or the seal we use. Because that will end up somewhere halfway the stream and is maybe easier to recycle than the end of life when it ends up at the consumer part. So all those kind of challenges we face, and in that trial and error, I would say, there's a lot of new ideas and initiatives, and they definitely need to continue, because I think that's where we need to gain our knowledge from. And you see them sometimes product-related, and sometimes they are supply chain-related, the new ideas, and sometimes they're even recycling-related. But they only solve part of the big puzzle. They never give one solution. Because what we think, there is no one solution. There's just no one solution. After a year of searching all information and talking to so many stakeholders in this whole supply chain, we find there's no one solution. There's definitely solutions, but to find the one, there's no option. Because it depends on the product. So where are you talking about? Depends on the supply chain. Where is the plastic going to? Depends on the user, and it depends on the country. So one solution, I'm sorry, we are not going to find, and that means another challenge. How do we get then part solutions? Now, after a long time thinking and talking to everybody, our management said, okay, it's nice that you did a lot of research, but now we have to start. Okay, we said, okay, we will start. You all know that, how that works. So we said, okay, what could we start then? The first one is refuse. I missed that one in the 3 R's of David because I love that one. Why don't we say no to things? Is it really necessary that we have a sleeve on this pot plant, or is it just marketing? Why is that sleeve there? It could be functional, it could be protecting your product, but sometimes it's just because we started it 20 years ago. Habits, behavior change. So we really look now at our individual product. What could we diminish and we just refuse? And then we look at reduce. So where could we change plastic into another, like carton or maybe another kind of substance? Not so easy, because the functionality still needs to be there. And plastic has just magnificent functionality. I mean, it is a perfect example of good ingenuity. Plastic is perfect, only the way how we use it and what we do with it is not so perfect at this moment. We started a recycling project. So we try now with one of our customers, how can we just collect back the trays and see if we can make a business case for that, and see if we can reuse those single-use trays and reuse them again as a raw material. And the next one is really interesting. We are really writing now a business case for reusable trays. And it sounds a bit strange maybe, but you really need a business case, because there's so much involved and so much cost involved on one end, on the current situation and in the new situation. But you need to know what stakeholders are involved and what costs are involved. So we're really busy with that, with the help of Flora Holland, but as well with other partners. We really try to get those numbers there. Because if you want to change your supplier and you want to change your customer, you want to change your supply chain, you need to prove that the changes you make are having impact, or are for similar cost, or if they're more expensive, you need to be able to explain to them why. So transparency here is a really important thing, and we're trying to make that business case at the moment. And a lot of information we do get from the fruit and vegetable situation, because they do use a lot of crates already. But if you see for pot plants, There's always the talk about hygiene and those trays need to be washed and whatever. And I do understand it because it could be a risk. But the trolleys we use, the CC's, they never be washed. And they always go into the greenhouse. So another behavior change. Is it really necessary to always wash those trays? Is that really necessary? So with making this business case, we come up with a lot of different side problems we have to solve and we have to get answers to. But it's actually a really nice one. And I hope that we can start somewhere this year. And the last project, and that's where I will hand over to José. My voice is anyway stopping, so that's fine, is Renew. Could we use different raw materials for the same kind of packaging material? So we are in the togetherness, really busy together with Van Dijk Flora in a project, how we can find other materials. And she will go and explain that to you. Thank you very much.
My name is José van der Klauw. I am a sustainability manager at Van Dijk Flora. I started in 2018, so last year, and which is quite some time after the company was established in 1972. I will elaborate a little bit on that. Van Dijk Flora was established in 72 as a part of Van Dijk Delft, which was an exporter of fruit and vegetables at that time. And it was situated in Den Hoorn, which is close to Delft, which explains the name, I guess. At a certain point, Van Dijk Delft went together with the greenery, and at that point, Van Dijk Flora thought, well, it would be better at home at another company. So they started to talk to Dutch Flower Group, and we became part of Dutch Flower Group. So we Van Dijk Flora have been part of Dutch Flower Group since 2007, and we are now located in Hanselersdijk, close to Naaldwijk, the auction. We specialize in supplying hard discount retailers, and they are located all over Europe. And like I say, we are part of Dutch Flower Group, so our sustainability policy was based on the same pillars as those of Dutch Flower Group, being those four pillars being one, our chain. Of course, we are not in this alone. We are working together with our chain. And we try to reach sustainability throughout that chain. So, for example, we, of course, comply with the standards of FSI. And we are quite happy to say that we are nicely on our way to reach 90% of sustainable purchasing of flowers and plants towards our retailers. But we also focus, of course, on the use of agrochemicals throughout the chain and the use of packaging and in general and plastics in particular. We also have our close partnerships. We strive to have sustainable partnerships, of course, with our sister companies within the Dutch Flower Group and also working together with partners like Royal Lemkes. But also our transporters or our packaging companies, we strive and for close relationships, and we challenge our partners always to be more sustainable. Of course, our people are our biggest asset, so that's another very strong pillar in our sustainability policy. We, like Royal Lemkes also, we provide for a healthy work environment, which gives them challenges to learn and to develop themselves all the time. So we strive for happy people, I guess. And of course, we're part of the world. Not only our world, it's the world of our customers, it's the world of our suppliers. And we invest in that world, for example, by supporting local sports clubs or investing in an organization like the Honey Highway, which strives for a better environment for the honeybees and stuff like health research such as on cancer. We are not operating only on our small world of horticulture, we are part of a world, and that's quite important also. Like I said, in those pillars, since I started, we have always been busy with trying to reduce our footprint in general, and while plastic and packaging may only be a small part of our CO2 footprint, it's very, very, like Elise said, annoying aspect of our business. So it's ever since I started, we have been trying and working on different kinds of materials and trying to substitute plastics. So it's been on our mind, and we have been testing different materials all along. At the same time last year, the Dutch government was looking for starting up a project in which it challenges companies to make better use of the quite huge amount of plastic waste that is still being incinerated to make energy. Like was said before, of course, it's making energy, but there's quite a good resource going to waste. And our government was challenging companies to find new solutions for those waste streams. So we at Van Dijk Flora thought, well, that should be an opportunity for horticulture. We use 180 million single-use trays each year throughout horticulture, producing 23 million kilograms of plastics. And of course, that's just the trays, and then we have the sleeves and the pots and the foil. So there's a lot of plastic going on. And whereas much of these plastics have functional requirements on strength or usability, but for example, in food industry, there's requirements on hygiene as well. Whereas the plastics can touch food, and that's not the case in our horticultural plastics often. So there seems to be an opportunity here for horticulture to put this use of to put this waste stream of plastic into use. So that's what we figured. We started out working on a proposal to joining this program from the government, and so it happens that Royal Lemkes was doing exactly the same thing at the same time. So. Our different contact persons asked us, well, can't you get together on that? And we said, both of us, Elise and I had a telephone conversation on Friday afternoon. He said, well, can we do this? Yes, of course we can do this. And on Monday afternoon, Elise's colleague and I were sitting on the table, merging our proposals and, supplying it within a few days. So we have a joint program and joint project now that is working on sustainable packaging solutions in horticulture. Our goal is to replace at least one or two current packaging solutions with packaging solutions made out of post-consumer plastic waste. This is a lot of research being done, and we're very happy that we have someone who can do this for us, because that takes quite a lot of time. So we are now actually in the process of finding out which are those resources, what are the kind of plastics that are being collected and are now going to waste. And then, of course, the next step will be what of these resources can be used best in horticulture. Once we have found out, we will ask our industry, our packaging suppliers, to help us and look for new and maybe old, but maybe new solutions to use this type of resource in our packaging solutions. And we're not going to just invite our usual suspects. We also want to involve people from outside of the sector who can look at it with a broader view and see what other things we can do and maybe find new solutions. So that's our first goal. Then we are working within a sector, and we will consult our sister companies. We will consult our companies that we are working together and find out the best solutions and pick one or two solutions that could be help us reach a lower impact. So our expected result is to have identified a number of packaging solutions that can be replaced by this solutions based on post-consumer waste. And this is only one, and Elise explained that very nicely. I think this is one of the possible solutions. We, both of us, we believe that horticultural packaging in the future will be functional and still and is more sustainable than it is in the current situation and still be competitive. But that means that we have to match raw materials with the right products and match products with users, supply chain, and the countries, because, you know, it was explained before, the waste system in Germany is different from that in the UK or Poland or Ukraine. So we have to find the right solutions for the right markets. So that was my story.